بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق أجمعين محمد وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم. The subject of discussion for tonight, inshallah, will be about the Shia Muslims who are the victims of terrorism throughout the history. Because the argument, or to say the wrong idea about Islam, that Islam is religion of terrorism or religion of sword and fighting and killing, to be fair, is not through the study of Holy Quran or the practice of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But then the, let us say, the Western scholars or others, you know, they study the history of the Muslim governments, Umayyad Caliphate or Abbasid Caliphate and Ottoman Caliphate and all that they study, and they see that they practice different types of injustice against human rights, dictatorship, and sometimes killing, attacking people in that. So they said Islam, but actually they do not represent Islam. We say Islam is represented by the teachings of the Holy Quran and the true and correct sayings of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. Again, this is important to know that not all sayings of the Prophet mentioned in the books, especially in the Sunni Muslim books, are correct. You know, there are a lot of traditions which are fake traditions, and the Holy Prophet did not say that. And naturally, presence of those traditions create problem in mind of the people that there is an idea of injustice in the judgments. Well, it is probably interesting to know that the Bukhari, or Sahih al-Bukhari, as the Sunni Muslims call it, and they refer to it as one of the two great correct books. Sahih means correct, all what ahadith are correct. Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, these two. The Bukhari himself at his time, he said, out of 600,000 traditions, I have gathered this, which is less than 7,000 tradition. So you imagine, at the time of Bukhari, who lived in the second century, about 200 years or 230-240 years after Hijra, till that time there are 600,000 fake hadith that Bukhari, out of that, choose almost 3%, which is 6,500-7,000 hadith. And Muslim, the same, he said, out of 300,000 hadith, I have chosen this number, which I think they are correct. So when we say there are fake hadith in books, it is not exaggeration. That is true, and the researchers should know. At the time of Bani Umayyah, they have made so much corruption in a hadith that unbelievable, and that is why 600,000 hadith were there, out of which, you know, only 7,000, the Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari, he said, I recommend they are right. Even with those 7,000, there is a lot of argument about some of his traditions that he has chosen. Anyhow, that is the situation. What I mean, the let's say the Orientalists or the scholars, when they said it, they said, okay, now Bani Umayyah did this, or Abu Bakr did that, or Umar did this, or Muawiyah did this, or Harun Rashid did that. They should not think that these are examples that represent true Islam, like the Holy Quran or the Holy Prophet. No, they are human beings, they do error, they do mistakes, and wrong things are there, right things are there. We have to refer for Islam to the right teachings of the Holy Prophet and Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, the 12 Imams, because we believe all of them are infallible. So whatever correct relation to them, correct hadith, related to them, then its meaning must be right. Okay, sometimes we do not understand the meaning, naturally we need to explain it. As in the previous lecture we explained about the verses of the Holy Quran, that some of them might create the confusion that there is type of killing, fighting, attacking others, but when it explained in the right way, we see that no, it was for certain situations, a defense against the non-believers, the idol worshippers who attack the Muslims, who create problem for Muslims, who called other tribes to attack the Muslims. So the Muslims were asked by Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to defend themselves and retaliate, as we discussed in detail in the last section. To be fair, you know, the Holy Prophet himself suffered of terrorism. Terrorism from whom? From the hypocrites. And also from the idol worshippers of Mecca. He was the first man to suffer because the people of Mecca tried many times to kill him secretly. Abu Sufyan sent someone and he was given a great prize to kill the Holy Prophet at time of the prayer, at night, etc. Well, the Holy Prophet knew that probably through revelation. And when he came, he told him, for what you have come? He said, I came just to see you and to see the friends in Medina and peacefully. He said, no, you were in meeting, in that meeting, and then they said, we will give this much money to anyone who will kill, and you came to kill me. Then when he heard that, and nobody knew about it, he said, well, it looks that you are a true and genuine prophet, and he became a Muslim, accepted Islam, and he said, I will go back and I will be as Muslim. So, you know, they tried many times. It is mentioned on seventh year of Hijrah, when the Battle of Khaybar finished, one of the women among the Jews, she brought meat with food and told the Prophet that I have an oath to give this food for your victory and welcome you. And she put poison in that. One of the Muslims were in hurry and he ate before the Prophet started eating. And when he ate from that, he died of the poison. The Holy Prophet, the shoulder of the goat, that was shoulder, the part of the shoulder, the meat, the shoulder told the Prophet that I am poisoned and do not eat from me. And the Holy Prophet brought her and brought her tribe and he said, you have put poison here. Well, she said, to be frank, O the Prophet of God, I said, if you are king and a ruler and a dictator who killed and attacked my people, then we'll get rid of you. And if you are a genuine prophet, this will not affect you and will not harm you. And now it is already declared, you know, the shoulder of the meat, you know, told you that it is poisoned. So the Prophet did not eat from that, left it. But you see, that type of attacks were there. Well, again, in life history of the Prophet, they tried, because he has appointed after him Imam Ali, his cousin and son-in-law, and, well, the greatest man in Islam after the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon them both. Then some of the people from Quraysh, they were not satisfied. They were not satisfied basically with the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, to be the Prophet. As the Holy Quran said, لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى رَجْلٍ مِنَ الْقَرِيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ. Why this Quran is for an orphan of Bani Hashim to be the Prophet? Why not one of the two great people among Quraysh who are rich, who are powerful, who are from a well-known tribe? Why not one of them to be chosen by God to be a prophet? So the people were looking at the prophethood like kingdom. Whoever has the power, has the money, has children, has fighters, then he deserves to be a prophet, like a king, you know. Of course, the prophethood is different, and Allah will choose the best people to be his messenger to the people. So that was mentality of Quraysh, you know. And when they found that the Holy Prophet appointed Imam Ali to be his successor, they said, well, after death of Prophet Muhammad, again, the power will be in hand of his cousin, and it will continue in hand of the tribe of Bani Hashim, Hashimites. And we will not agree with that. So they tried to kill the Prophet one time in Aqaba when he came from Tabuk on 9th year of Hijrah. He has to pass between two mountains. It's very critical road. And they were at the top of the mountain and throw stones so that the camel where the Prophet is riding, it will jump and will throw the Prophet down to the end of the valley. And there, you know, it is by support of God, miracle of Almighty God, it is mentioned that the angel Gabriel came and asked the camel to be firm, and then enlightening happened, and the Holy Prophet saw them all, the hypocrites. And then he crossed safely, and the rest of the army crossed. Then they told him, kill them, because they tried to kill you. He said, no, I will not kill them, so that it will not be said that Muhammad killed his companions. قَتَلَ مُحَمَّدٌ لَإِلَّا يُقَالْ قَتَلَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَصْحَابَهُ. Should not be said that Prophet Muhammad killed his companions. And he put name of companions with one of the Sahaba who was known that he know the names of the hypocrites, the munafiqin. And that gentleman, it is mentioned in history at time of Umar, he said, on a Friday I will come to the mosque and I will tell the people facts that they do not know. Probably he want to expose the hypocrites. On Wednesday he was killed and they did not know who killed him. Now you see the assassination of those who follow the right path is always there. Well, even by the, well, hypocrites are there in the society. Well, the other time they tried to kill the Prophet is with the, when they wrote the, they call sahifa, let us say, letter, treaty between them, five of them, and they said in it, لَإِن مَاتَ مُحَمَّدْ, if Muhammad dies, not the Prophet, not the Messenger, just Muhammad. It means that they do not believe he is prophet or a messenger of God. If Muhammad dies, لَنَزْوِيَنَّ الْأَمْرَ عَنْ أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ, the government affairs will take it away from his household. And they had that treaty and sent the letter to be buried in Kaaba, in Mecca, from Medina to be buried in Kaaba. And the Holy Prophet knew that, and he told Imam Ali about it, that the people, five people are those, they are known among his very near companions, and they were hypocrites. They were coordinating with Abu Sufyan, with people of Mecca, and he said, we will not allow the family of the Prophet, I mean Imam Ali being cousin, to be the Imam and the ruler of the Muslim Ummah, the Caliph, what is called. And Nazwiyanna means we take away the government from his household. And then at end of life of the Prophet, well, it is said, when they call ludud, ludud, lud means giving medicine to the patient. You led. And it is said, there are many traditions from Aisha, from others, that we gave the Prophet medicine and he was unconscious. When he was awake, he said, why did you give me medicine? Did I tell you, do not give me that medicine? And they said, no, you are patient, and the patient usually do not like medicine. See, they look to the Prophet like a child, you know. He's a child and he needs medicine, and because the child will not like medicine, the mother has to force him. Well, all that naturally, you know, it is not true, so there must be something wrong with that medicine. It must be poisoned. And there is a hadith, he said, this has come from Ethiopia, from Abyssinia, because Abyssinia were known to have a poisonous medicine to be brought, and he pointed out whom has poisoned him. Of course, is almost unanimously accepted by Muslims, well, Shias and Sunnis, that the Holy Prophet died as by poison, died as martyr. He did not die in ordinary death. But they say it was the poison of the Jewish lady on seventh year of Hijrah, and that remained in its effect till he killed the Prophet. Well, after 4 years, naturally, poison will not kill. Either will kill right away or will not kill. Secondly, the Holy Prophet did not eat from that, did not eat from that, you know. Well, he was supposed to eat. One of his companions ate from it and he died. The Holy Prophet did not eat because the shoulder told him, I am poisoned, and the Holy Prophet did not touch it. Well, there are a lot of details, I'm not going, but they said the Holy Prophet died due to poison. Now, which poison? That poison of the Jewish lady on seventh year of Hijrah, 4 years before his death, naturally, is not affecting. So it must be a new poison, probably was given to the Prophet gradually many times, because he got sick, he got fever for a few days, and then they gave him more and more of that medicine. They said that is good for him, and ultimately he died. So we see that the terrorism started with terrorizing the Prophet himself by the hypocrites. I'm giving all these details. I said, do not blame the Prophet or the Holy Quran if there are some people who are hypocrites, who are not true Muslims, and they claim to be a Muslim when they do something wrong. And you say, no, Islam is Islam is not encouraging. Even the Holy Prophet himself suffered from the hypocrites at his time. Actually, it is said that the Holy Quran, in the verses which were revealed in Mecca at the beginning of Islam, the main subject of discussion was about Tawheed, oneness of Almighty God, believe in God and oneness of God. And the verses revealed in Medina, the main subject to expose the hypocrites, because there the phenomena of hypocrites started. You see one full surah, Suratul Munafiqun, that full surah about hypocrites. So many ayahs about hypocrites, what they do, what are their plans, these all details are mentioned. So naturally it must be a big phenomena. Not that one, two, three people are there. No, the Holy Quran will not come because one person is there and he make it a phenomena. No, it must be a big phenomena widely spread in that society. However, after death of the Prophet right away, the first, let us say, government terrorism against the Muslims started when they attacked house of Imam Ali alayhi salam and Fatima al-Zahra. They asked Imam Ali to come by force and pledge allegiance to Abu Bakr. Imam Ali said, well, the Holy Prophet appointed me and you have pledged allegiance to me in Eid al-Ghadir about 70 days before that. So how soon you forgot that I am the ruler, not you? They said, no, either you come or by force we'll bring you. Three, four times they sent people and they returned back. Ultimately, they brought fire and put the fire at the door, and then smoke filled, and they said, we'll burn the house. Well, the second was there and they told him that how you burn the house, and this house is Fatima. Fatima is daughter of the Prophet. She is Sayyidat Nisa al-Alameen, the mistress of the women of the world. He said, well, even if there is Fatima, we don't care. We will burn the house. You see, that is state terrorism against Ahlul Bayt. So the Imams and the leaders of the Shias were the first one to suffer after death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Well, we know the story that Fatima Zahra was oppressed between the door and the wall, and she miscarried her baby. They slapped her on her face, and then they sabbed with stripes. And they took Imam Ali by force and tried to kill him, or he pledged allegiance to Abu Bakr. Imam Ali refused. Then Fatima al-Zahra, with all her sickness after miscarriage, she came out of the house to the mosque and said, either you leave Imam Ali or I pray to Almighty God in order to bring punishment upon you. And when she tried to pray, they found the sign of punishment is coming. Even they said the wall of the mosque were open, that big opening, not a small crack, that a person can pass, you know, so it was a big opening, even a person can pass there. And when they found the risk, Imam Ali told Salman that reach Fatima and ask her not to pray, otherwise all the people will die. And he came and he told that you are daughter of the Prophet, your father was mercy for mankind, rahmah lil alameen. Don't be a cause that all these people will be dead, you know. You know, like, you know, Ad and Thamud, Allah killed them all, then Allah can kill all those hypocrites. Then she stopped and then they left Imam Ali to go back home. So that is, you know, after the Prophet, the first, what we call, state terrorism started. Well, a lot of suffering, even Fatima was crying at home for the death of her father. They said, send a message to Imam Ali that tell Fatima either she cry in the daytime or in the nighttime. She's not allowed to cry. Even crying and weeping for death of the father, like a prophet, not ordinary father, they said not allowed. Then Imam Ali took her to Baqiyah, the graveyard in Medina, and she used to be under a tree and cry for the death of the prophet there. Then they came and cut the tree so that there will be no shadow for her. And then Imam Ali built a small room so that she had a shadow there till she died within about 3 months after death of the Prophet, and that is due to effect probably of the nail which has entered in her chest when she was pressed between the door and the wall. After that, naturally, they started the terrorism against Imam Ali. Imam Ali was very peaceful because he knows he will be killed. Now, no supporter like Fatima al-Zahra is to support him, and the people were against him. Even at the time of Fatima al-Zahra, Imam Ali came complaining to Fatima al-Zahra. He said, oh, Fatima, do you know what is happening to me? It is not that the people will not start greeting me, will not start salam to me. Even when I say salam to them, when I greet them, they will not respond to my greeting. Imagine Imam Ali, the Imam, the cousin of the Prophet, son-in-law of the Prophet, the greatest man in Islam. The people boycotted him, that even when he come and greet the people in a place, they turn their face, do not care to reply to him. Why? We know the response to the greeting is obligatory in Islam. Somebody tell you salam alaikum, it is wajib, obligatory to say alaikum salam. But Imam Ali suffered this much from the people. Now, another one who suffered is Sa'd ibn Abada, who was head of the Khazraj. And he was not pledging allegiance with Abu Bakr and Umar, because he said that you are not the right caliph, the right caliph is Imam Ali and you are not the right one. They said, okay, and then secretly they sent somebody to kill him, and they claimed the jinn killed him, and they had poetry of two lines, نَحْنُ قَتَلْنَا سَيِّدَ الْخَزْرَةِ سَعْدَ بْنَ عَبَادَ أَدْرَمَيْنَاهُ بِسَهْمَيْنْ فَلَمْ نُخْتِ فُعَادَ. So they said, we hear the jinn at night reciting this poetry that we have killed the master of Khazraj tribe, Sa'd son of Abada, and we throw two arrows, and that did not mistake his heart, you know. Naturally, we know the jinn will not kill and will not recite poetry, and naturally, assassination was there, political assassination, let us say. Well, again, Malik ibn Nuwayra, who was one of the companions of the Prophet, and he was living outside the Medina. When he came to Medina and he saw Abu Bakr sitting on the pulpit of the Prophet, they told him, pay your zakat to Abu Bakr. He said, well, the Holy Prophet told me if I dies, then Imam Ali is the caliph after me, and I cannot pledge allegiance to Abu Bakr. When the Prophet told me, and I heard it from the Holy Prophet himself, I pay my zakat to Imam Ali. Well, they sent Khalid ibn al-Walid with an army to kill him, and they said he is murtad, he is away of Islam, that's not Muslim. He was a Muslim, and he only said zakat, he believes in paying zakat, but said zakat should not be paid to Abu Bakr, should be paid to Imam Ali, that's all. Khalid ibn al-Walid, he knows that he and the tribe were very brave, he cannot kill them. And he came peacefully, he said, well, I came just to negotiate. I said, then why your arm in hand? He said, okay, we'll keep our swords. And they prayed together. At the time of the prayer, when the people were busy, Khalid ibn al-Walid told his army that attack them and capture all the that people. So they captured them all. And then at night he said, kill them. And he slaughtered them all in that night. And actually in that night he raped wife of Malik ibn Urwa, because he said, she is my captive. She is a Muslim and her husband is a Muslim, but still they were terrorized in that way. Not only that, they tried also to kill Imam Ali and asked Khalid ibn al-Walid at time of the prayer to pray beside Imam Ali. When Abu Bakr finished the prayer, then he stand and kill him. The sword is in his hand, and Imam Ali is not coming with arm to the mosque, literally. They come with ordinary dress in a peaceful way. And then at time of Tashahud before Salam, Abu Bakr felt sorry for that, and he said it may create a lot of confusion, a little problem. And he said, well, that was not a good decision. Then he said, oh Khalid, do not do what I told you to do. Then he said, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and he finished the prayer. So Imam Ali asked Khalid, what was the thing that you were supposed to do? He said, well, it was supposed to kill you. He said, do you dare to kill me? He said, yes, I would have killed you. Then Imam took a spear, put it in his neck, and turned it, so the spear now is hanged in his neck, you know. And he said, if you are brave, take it out. Now, a spear is very strong, and by the strength of Imam Ali, it was screwed. Now, who can unscrew it, you know? If they heat the spear to be a little soft, naturally it will burn him. And if they keep it cold, nobody there. They went to Medina, they tried all the people, they said, nobody can do it, you know. Then later on they came and said, oh Ali, please forgive us this and that. Then Imam Ali unscrewed it. And so you see that how much Imam Ali suffered. Well, I forget to say about Fatima al-Zahra that not only they attacked her house, they also had an economic sanctions, again, the economic terrorism, let us say. They took all her money which was given to her by the Prophet, and that is Fadak. And there are other gardens which were given a gift from the Prophet to Fatima al-Zahra. And for 3 years it was in hand of Fatima al-Zahra. She had appointed somebody to look after that, and all the income used to come every year from agriculture. And she used to spend it on the poor people in Medina. So they usurped that also from Fatima al-Zahra. Though she came and delivered a great sermon known, but then they did not listen to that. And then we see after that, when Imam Ali alayhi salam anyhow become the ruler after 25 years from Hijrah, I mean at the year 35 after assassination of Uthman. Well, again, the, let us say, type of state terrorism started. Muawiyah did not pledge allegiance to Imam Ali. Talha and Zubair, who already pledged allegiance with Imam Ali, they wanted to give them the government to be the governor of Basra and Kufa, one for Basra, one for Kufa. Imam Ali knows they do not deserve that position. He said no. He said, oh, we have supported you, we're with you. He said, well, but religiously I'm responsible. You do not. You are not suitable for that. So they hate Imam Ali, and they said, okay, you are going to Mecca for Umrah. Imam Ali said, no, you are not going for Umrah. You have a plan in mind. He said, no, no, by God. He said, okay, pledge allegiance again to me. They pledged allegiance with Imam Ali again, and then went to Mecca, and then with Aisha, they raised an army and came to Basra, and then killed a lot of people in Basra who were supporter of Imam Ali, and had an army to fight with Imam Ali. Imam Ali also moved from Medina to Kufa to Basra, and the Battle of Jamal started. Well, 60,000 people, it is said, some said 40,000, well, thousands of people were killed. Ultimately, Imam Ali was victorious, and Talha and Zubair were killed. Imam Ali, when he captured Aisha, he sent her with honor to Medina, because she is anyhow wife of the Prophet, to be respected for that purpose. After that, Muawiyah had the war, and that war took almost 1 year, about 10 months, between, let us say, Iraqis and people of Sham. And again, tens of thousands were killed. And there also end with a trick of Muawiyah, when Imam Ali's army were nearly to succeed. They raised the Quran on the spears, and they said, let the Quran be judged between both of us, and then the army stopped the war. Ultimately, they make a trick with the judges, and they did not surrender. Then, after that, the Kharijis, we call the Khawarij, certain group of people, now they, because they found the trick of Muawiyah is there, and Muawiyah remained in power, they told Imam Ali, why you accepted the judgment? Imam Ali said, you were the people who forced me. Because in Battle of Siffin, 30,000 men came with the sword in hand and said, oh Ali, Muawiyah is calling you for the Holy Quran, accept that. Imam Ali said, well, I am the speaking Quran, that is the written Quran, I am the speaking Quran. And I know the Quran, this is a trick. They said, no, no, because he's calling you for the Holy Quran, you have to accept it. Imam Ali said, okay, I put a man on my behalf, Imam Hassan, to represent me in negotiation. They said, no. He said, Imam Hussein, they said, no. He said, Ibn Abbas, they said, no. Only Abu Musa al-Ash'ari to be there. He said, Abu Musa is not suitable, is not, not he, the Muawiyah had Amr ibn al-As, that is very clever man, he can play game with Abu Musa. They said, no, not this one, otherwise we'll kill you. Now you can imagine the problems Imam Ali faced. And then Imam Ali well surrendered, and then we put Abu Musa. Amr ibn al-As first showed himself to respect Abu Musa al-Ash'ari a lot. And they said, okay, both of us will take out our partner. You say Imam Ali is not caliph, I say Muawiyah is not caliph, and let Muslims elect anyone. Abu Musa thought, al-Ash'ari thought that is a good idea. So he first attended the pulpit, because Amr al-As said, you are elder, you have to go first, you are respected. When he came and he said, well, I took caliphate out from Imam Ali like I take the ring from my finger. And he came down. Now, the same thing was supposed to be done by Amr ibn al-As. Amr ibn al-As went out up to the pulpit and the ring was out. He said, I fixed Muawiyah for caliphate as I am fixing the ring in my finger. So now they knew that this was treachery. Anyhow, that a trick was there, then confusion happened in the army that what is this trick? Then they said, why we have accepted the treaty, peace treaty in beginning? Imam Ali said, well, you forced me, I did not. I told you that I am the speaking Quran, I know this is a trick. They said, no, no, it is wrong and it is a mistake and it is a sin. And then they had their philosophy, anybody who do any sin become kafir. Not that is fasiq, no, it's a kafir. Any sin, you are kafir. Either you repent or you are kafir to be killed. Any small sin. That's philosophy of Kharijis. Well, then they created a war against Imam Ali and a lot were killed. And ultimately, Abdurrahman ibn Muljim, one of the Kharijis, in the morning prayer, he came and with his sword attacked Imam Ali. It was a poisonous sword, and it was on the 19th of month of Ramadan, and then Imam Ali were martyred at the 21st of month of Ramadan. So you see the suffering of Ahlul Bayt, as I'm saying, you know. Well, after him, Imam Hassan was the Imam and the leader. And then Imam Hassan also suffered. Muawiyah sent poison to wife of Imam Hassan, Ju'da, daughter of Al-Ash'ath, and his wife, Imam Hassan's wife, they give him poison and poisoned Imam Hassan, and then Imam Hassan also died. So now you see the terrorism planned by Muawiyah, by the government, and done by the people, let us say, wife of Imam Hassan alayhi salam. When they brought Imam Hassan to bury him beside the Prophet, Aisha and Bani Umayyah all came and they said, no, we will not allow. Well, how they will not allow? Well, they allowed Abu Bakr and Umar to be buried beside the Prophet, and they are not related to the Prophet, while Imam Hassan is a grandson of the Prophet. Why is not allowed to be buried? They said no, and then they had the arrows, and it is said 70 arrows they throw toward the body of Imam Hassan. He said, no, we'll kill everybody who... And Imam Hassan, before his death, he told Imam Hussein that do not fight, for if they refuse, I should be buried beside my grandfather, you bury me in Baqi'. And Imam Hussein said to the rest of Bani Hashim, well, do not fight. It is the will of my brother that we should not fight. And then they took the body to Baqi', the graveyard in Medina, well-known graveyard called Baqi', and he was buried there. So you see that how much that is continuous. And then when Muawiyah, let us say, after death of Imam Ali, for 6 months Imam Hassan was the Imam, and then Muawiyah made peace treaty with Imam Hassan, and one of the conditions of peace treaty were not to kill anyone of the Shias, and not to harass them, and not to cut the salary, which is monthly support for their orphans and widows and all that. Muawiyah agreed with all that, signed it, but then when he was in power, he sent Ziyad ibn Abi to be the ruler of Basra and Kufa, and he killed thousands of Shias who were followers of Imam Ali and Imam Hassan. And well, till in the year 50, 10 years after that, when Imam Hassan was poisoned. So in that 10 years, thousands of Shias were killed against the peace treaty signed by Muawiyah with Imam Hassan. One of them was Amr ibn al-Hamq al-Khuza'i, who was very pious, very great man, very honorable man, reciting the Holy Quran in the mosque. Now, Ziyad ibn Abi, the ruler in Kufa, could not find any excuse to kill him, but you know that he is a good follower of Imam Ali. He sent a letter to Muawiyah that you have to kill him. Then Muawiyah said, well, if we come here, I have no reason to kill him. You kill him. He said, I cannot, and you kill him. And see, like that, then he said, okay, send him. And then he was, he ran away, and he was in Mosul secretly, in a secret place. They took his wife, and later on, his wife in jail. His wife is innocent. They took, then he was fined, he was killed, and his head was sent, and they sent the head as a gift to the wife in jail, and they released the wife. You can imagine that. Hajar ibn Adi also was a great man. Hajar ibn Adi was one of the great companions of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Well, the same thing, Ziyad wanted to kill him, and he captured him ultimately, did not run away, and was sent with a group of Shias, true Shias, Shia Muslims. And when they reached in the, let us say, valley of Sham, you know, before entering Damascus, then Muawiyah sent an army to kill them there, so they will not come to the city, people should not see that. And they dig the grave in front of them and killed him and killed his son and killed all his companions. And Muawiyah, for end of his life, he used to say, إِنَّ يَوْمِي مِنْكَ يَا حَجْرُ لَطَوِيلُ. My day of questioning in the day of judgment, because of you, will be very long. I will get long questioning in the Day of Judgment because I killed your innocent, completely innocent. Why he was killed? Because he was a Shia. So you can imagine Shia Muslims were terrorized from the beginning of Islam. And that continued till, we know, the year 60 or 61 after Hijrah, when Imam Hussein alayhi salam and his 18 of his family members and 72 companions were killed in Karbala and assassinated, and that greatest tragedy in Islam, actually in history of humanity, happened. And they beheaded the bodies and took the heads with the women and children as captives to Kufa and then to Sham for Yazid, and then Yazid released them. You can imagine such type of a state terrorism for nothing, because you say, Imam Hussein, either you pledge allegiance or we'll kill you. He said, well, I will leave you, I will go anywhere in the world. I'm not, they say, no, you have to pledge allegiance or we'll kill you. So there was no right to choose the ruler or even to live peacefully. He said, no, we'll kill you. And he was killed in that tragedy. And we read in the history, all our imams, you know, after him, that Imam Zain al-Abidin was poisoned, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir was poisoned, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq was poisoned, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far was jailed many times and poisoned, Imam al-Ridha also poisoned, and so on, till 11th Imam, all of them were ultimately poisoned and were martyred. None of them died a normal death. And then the 12th Imam, Imam al-Mahdi, because Allah wanted to keep him alive for end of the time, to fill the earth with justice and equity after being filled with injustice and tyranny. So he went into occultation by will of God, and till now he's in occultation. So what I mean, if Imam al-Mahdi also would not have been in occultation, he would have been terrorized as well, you know. But it is will of God, put him in occultation so that we'll be saved. And when we come to the followers of Amir al-Mu'mineen, well, after Muawiyah, when Yazid came, then the ruler of Yazid, Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, had not only sent the army to kill Imam Hussein, he had thousands of Shias, 4,500 Shias in jail, and a lot of them were killed. One of them was Maytham al-Tammar, the well-known companion of Imam Ali alayhi salam. He killed tens of thousands of Shias in Iraq, in Kufa and Basra and all the tribe, for no reason except love to Imam Ali. That's for only for that, no other reason for that. And then later on, after that, Marwan and Abdul Malik ibn Marwan and Yazid ibn Abdul Malik and so on, the rest of Bani Umayyah who ruled at the time of Abdul Malik, Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, he was the ruler of Iraq. He also killed tens of thousands of people. I mean, even the children, when they grow and they love Imam Ali, he killed the father, now he killed the children. Even the women were captives, and it is said 120,000 prisoners was in his jail. You can imagine this number at that time. Population was not much, and this much people were there, because people of Iraq, basically, they love Ahlul Bayt. Well, that suffering continued when some of the descendants of Ahlul Bayt, like Zayd ibn Ali, Zayd son of Imam Zain al-Abidin, he could not tolerate that tyranny, and he took a stand against them. They killed him, and they hanged his body for 3 years, and ultimately they burned the body and throw the ash in the water, you know. You can imagine what they did to him. After him, the Hassanis, the descendants of Imam Hassan, the Nafs al-Zakiyya and others, you know, they revolted against the tyranny, and they were killed and beheaded very brutally. Well, in the time of Abbasid, it happened in about 70 people of the descendants of the Prophet from Imam Hassan, this Hassani Sayyid. Did not pledge allegiance with Mansur al-Dawaniqi, and he killed them in Fakh. Fakh is near Mecca, you know, in that area, and a tragedy similar to Karbala. Even the head of the Hassanis were called Hussein ibn Ali, But they say Hussein ibn Ali of Fakh, not Hussein ibn Ali, Imam Hussein, who is in Karbala. And he was killed unjustly because they were Sayyid and they were descendants of Prophet and they do not recognize the Abbasid Caliphate. Well, continued after that, you know, when Imam al-Kadhim, the seventh Imam, was put in jail for many years and then ultimately was poisoned in jail, his son al-Qasim, he went out and he could not show himself and ultimately he died in the area near Hilla of today, al-Qasim there. Well, the sons of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far and his daughter Fatima al-Ma'suma, his sons who migrated from Medina to go to Khurasan because Imam al-Ridha was the crown prince of Ma'mun and they came to support Imam al-Ridha, then they killed them in an attack in Shiraz, and then those who were saved with Fatima, sister of Imam al-Ridha, they poisoned her and they attacked, they killed the men, and they poisoned her and she came to Qom and died in Qom. So you see all that continuous, that is in the history of time of the Imams. Well, after the Imams, at time of Abbasids, you know, hundreds, rather thousands of the Sayyids and the Shias were killed by al-Mahdi al-Abbasi, by Harun al-Rashid, after that by al-Mutawakkil and so on. All they killed the Shias. Well, after that, when Abbasid dynasty finished and the Ottoman dynasty came, Turkish dynasty started, they call Khilafah al-Uthmaniyya. Again, they killed the Shias, especially the Alawi Shias in Turkey. A great massacre was there. And then they run away to the mountains. Till today, they live in the mountains in Turkey because of that massacre and killing thousands of them. Well, even in Iraq, thousands were killed. Well, among our ulama, we have the Shaheed al-Awwal, the first martyr alim, the Shaheed al-Thani, Shaheed al-Thalith, Shaheed al-Rabi. All our great ulama, they lived in an area, in Shaheed al-Awwal was in Sham, and they didn't know that he is a Shia, but later on when they know he is a Shia and he is a great man and he is a great alim, they killed him. And that was the first martyr. And then the second one. And the third one is Qadi Nurullah Tustari in Agra, where Taj Mahal is there in India. He was appointed as the chief judge for the government because of his great knowledge. And he said, I will give fatwa to any one of the five Muslim sects, not necessary to any four. But then always his judgment was according to Shia Muslim beliefs, because always one of the four sects, either Hanafi is similar, or Maliki, or Hanbali, or Shafi'i, they were similar to Shias. So later on when they discovered that he is a Shia, they killed him and his grave is there. Well, in Iraq, we know in the last 100 years how many alim were killed, especially in the last 35 years of ruling of Saddam and Ba'ath Party. What a great number of ulama from the religious families and the general people, probably to be fair in number, about 3 million Shias were killed, either in jail by torture or in the first Gulf War or in the second Gulf War, and all that terrorism continues even after that from 2003 till today, because Shia has now had some freedom and there is election in Iraq and they show that majority of the people of Iraq are Shias and the government is in hand of Shia prime minister, though the president is Sunni, the head of parliament is Sunni, but still the ex-Ba'athis or Al-Qaeda or others, they do not like that and they put bomb here and there and kill the Shias everywhere. The minimum number which is said, 150,000 till now were killed from 2003 till now, some said up to 1 million or 1.5 million, because there are hundreds of thousands people killed, they cannot be counted. So actually the Shia Muslims are the victims of terrorism and in hand of other hypocrites and dictators who call themselves Muslims. So if, let us say, non-Muslim, an injustice done to him, he should know that this is not the teaching of Islam, because still many Muslims are suffering of that. Of course, there are many cases when even other Muslim sects were suffering from other. Sometimes Hanbalis are in power, the Shafi'is are killed. Sometimes Shafi'is are in power, the Hanbalis or Hanafis are killed. And well, politics, governments in the history played with that government, and they allow this group to kill that and that group to kill this, and create that confusion. So it is not really Islamic teaching or the Holy Prophet teaching. It is the dictators who ruled in name of Islam, and that is the what they did. I think this will elaborate the situation, and naturally the subject needs volumes of books to written about all detail. Actually, one full book written, I mean, very old book by Abu al-Faraj al-Isfahani called Maqatil al-Talibiyin, the assassinations of Al Abi Talib and descendants of Abu Talib, uncle of the Prophet. They were called the Sayyids, were called Talibiyin. Full book you write about them one by one, where they have been assassinated and killed and eradicated. I mean, that is in those time, you know, in the third century. Now, from third century till now, which is we started 15th Hijri century, you imagine how many millions of Shias were killed in different areas. We hope that Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give success to the sincere believers and fill the earth with justice and equity after being filled with injustice and tyranny, and hasten reappearance of Imam al-Mahdi alayhi salam in order to fill the earth with peace. والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وآله